Sorry, just the message just popped up there. I don't want to give too much away, so apologies for the abrupt introduction, but I'm hoping all of you will be able to give yourself a much better introduction than I can. I think let's probably dive straight into it. Also, I guess the people are kind of here to hear from you, not me so much this evening. So as I mentioned earlier, we'll start with Steve. So Steve, welcome this evening. I hope you've had a good day, and I hope you're going to have a really good evening with us this evening. First question, I guess, who are you? Can you give us a little bit about you and your role and how long you've done it for?
Okay, my name's Steve Elliott. I'm a counsellor at the Centre for Wellbeing, but with a special responsibility for matters of equality, diversity and inclusion. And in particular, in the provision of support for students and staff from Black, Asian and ethnic minority groups who need particular support. I've been in this position it's a very new position, not just for a few months. I started back in April, though I've been associated with the Centre for Wellbeing for 4 or 5 years. So that's how I've come to be at the University of Surrey.
Amazing. So in terms of your actual role, what does the day-to-day look like for you, Steve?
As I say, the role specifically is looking at supporting those from minority backgrounds, but I do work with whoever comes requiring emotional mental health support. So a typical day could be 4, 5, 6 clients, and dealing with, at the moment, we've got a number of students really struggling, some in suicidal places, and a number who struggle with being from a minority group and struggling to fit in, especially those who've come from overseas.
It must be a really interesting role, just kind of, like you said, you're working with a number of different ethnic minorities. Going to university, and in particular being in that forum as an ethnic minority, is difficult enough as it is, because you are, again, I guess, in another minority, sort of being placed in higher education or finding yourself in higher education, finding yourself in different places across the country, having to deal with people that you might not have spoken to before. There must be a huge amount of things that students come to you with. How do you deal with that as a person?
Well, this will take me back to what I used to do before I came to the university. Back in the 90s, I was a church minister. And so many times I was supporting single moms, fatherless boys, many from minority backgrounds, many struggling with their ethnicity. And this was much of a vocation for me, to be supporting and helping individuals. At the time, I was running a business, and still am, in the sports and hospitality field. But this vocation always sat with me. So when I had the opportunity to go to the University of Greenwich and do my degree in psychotherapy and counselling, it allowed what that is essentially me to be able to use that in this area. Many of the students who are here are going through that period of life where they're learning to become independent adults. Carrying a bit of baggage as well makes it very difficult when individuals are away from home, away from family, away from that which they're used to. So supporting them through their pain, through their struggles, is what makes up most of my day.
Yeah, I can imagine. And I mean, it's really interesting. You obviously have a skill and a want and a need to help people. And I think that's quite rare in, this is going to sound quite horrible, but I think it's a bit quite rare in professions. I think a lot of professions don't kind of offer that sort of personal touch or that rewarding side of things. I mean, what influenced you, or who influenced you, to kind of go down that route?
To be honest, I didn't have any particular influences. I grew up in the 60s and 70s. So my main inspirations were people like Martin Luther King, were people like Muhammad Ali, who helped me as I was growing up to recognize, okay, I'm from a minority, but I can get through this. If I can find a way to use that which is within me to the fullest, my ethnicity shouldn't get in the way. And that was espoused by Martin Luther King, by Muhammad Ali. In more recent times, some of my own colleagues, some of the people I've met on my journey through studying, through my training at Greenwich University, a number of my colleagues inspired me, because many also came from difficult backgrounds, but with a willingness and a desire to help people. And that kept me going.
Yeah. No, that's awesome. I mean, I'm assuming, like we all have in our careers, whether that's short or long or however long you've been doing something, that you would have faced a number of obstacles or challenges throughout your career. Are there any like standouts that you can kind of really put your finger on and maybe go into a little bit of detail about now?
Yeah, being black and being male in the counselling profession is very rare. In fact, when I was studying throughout the 4 or 5 years I was doing my degree, I was with 17 middle-class white English women and me. And so it was very difficult to work with sharing experiences that many of them had no idea about, had never experienced the life I had experienced, and the challenges that I've experienced throughout my life, and continue to. And even when coming to the Centre for Wellbeing at the university initially, again, the demographic was very, very singular, very linear. So I was the one who stood out. And to be honest, much of my life has been the one who's different. But I never let that get in the way. My desire to fulfill my vocation would always get me through. And in the end, my life experience was beginning to enrich those who hadn't seen what life is like for someone from an ethnic minority. So that was a great challenge. Especially being a man as well in a female-dominated environment, that was difficult, but managed to overcome it, and now find myself in a role whereby so many people are seeking out a man, and a man from an ethnic minority group, to support them and to hear them and to understand their experiences.
Yeah, I mean that's so interesting. I mean, you kind of going back to where you were saying about how you were in a classroom with 17 middle-class white ladies. I think it's really important for us to remember as humans, not just as different ethnicities, that Black History Month is very much about the celebration of Black culture and Black people, but it's not only Black people that should be doing that. And I know we've got a number of white ladies and different ethnicities in the talk this evening. So was there any allyship, I'm assuming there must have been, during sort of your learning process with the ladies that were in your class? How did you help them understand your ethnicity? Because they're going to have dealt with a number of Black students throughout their career. And how did they help you? It must have been reciprocal.
It was difficult, I would say. I would say it was difficult. What was encouraging was that many of my peers, through my training, were keen to understand. They wanted to learn more about what it was like to grow up in a South London borough, especially during the late 70s and 1980s, where there was a great deal of racial tension. My experiences and what drew me to the church, what enabled me to serve as a minister. Many of my peers were keen to learn and understand that. Their willingness to understand and their willingness to hear has been quite inspirational for me, because I could have gone into that situation that, I'm just going to be out on the margins here. I'm just going to have to sit quietly. I can't, but that wasn't my experience in the end. It's left me with this sense of optimism that as time is going on, that people from all backgrounds, especially people from the dominant culture, are more willing now to understand and to engage, which wasn't my experience when I was a young man.
Mm. So I'm guessing times are changing and you're seeing that, which is super positive. Stephen, I think we could sit and probably talk for ages, but we've got other panel guests this evening. So just want to say thank you very much for that. And I'm sure obviously we'll hear from you a lot more throughout the evening as well. We're going to move on to the next guest. Lisa, I'm going to choose you next, if that's okay. I hope you're well. Kind of the same sort of opening question, really, Lisa, is just to find out a little bit about you, your background, how you kind of got into your role, and if you could just give everybody an insight into what that role is as well, that'd be awesome.
Okay, hi everyone, I'm Lisa Bent, and I am currently a senior people manager at Landor and Fitch, which is a large advertising and brand transformation company. I've been in this role for 6 months, but I've been in HR for 10 years. I fell into this role. Like Stephen, I'm also a counsellor, and I actually also studied at Greenwich University. So that's really interesting. I was a counsellor before I fell into HR, and the reason why I was no longer doing HR is because counselling is because I took a break. I was specialising in sexual abuse. The work is needed, it's important, but it does take strips out of you. And the impact for me was that I had secondary post-traumatic stress disorder of the information that I was hearing. And in order to protect myself, I felt like I just needed time out. So I ended up on the reception desk of Turner Broadcasting, which is now part of Warner Media. And I was there on and off for maybe 6 months. And then an opportunity came in HR. My name got bandied about because I was literally the go-to person. I knew everyone in that office. It's over 1,000 people because of my counselling skills.
Yeah.
So people would come down and, when you talk about in the workplace, there's like the office cooler moment. Yeah. My reception desk was the cooler moment where people would come down and have a little chat. So I knew everything. So when this role came up and people were just bandying about my name, HR were like, who is this Lisa Bent? Let's have an interview with her. Had the interview, got the job, and basically never looked back in terms of being in HR. Love the role, love the job. HR is definitely more than just hiring and firing. And that's something that I really need people to understand, because that is the reputation that we kind of have, but we're so much more than that. We strategize, we're people champions, but we're also aligned with the business. So our job is to try and align what the people want, what the business needs are, and try and find a mutual ground in order to retain. Because if you don't find mutual ground, you're going to get people who leave. So I look at strategy. I look at trying to find more ways to improve employee engagement, about health and well-being. So we do a number of initiatives here. And really interesting initiative, especially as we've come out of it, in lockdown and coming out of lockdown. My day is very varied. I'm very operational. The company have just merged. So we've gone from like 70 people to 240 people in 6 months. My team's grown. And it's literally at the moment just about connecting people face to face now that we are coming out of the lockdown restrictions. Really interesting. Lovely people, but HR is definitely a different kind of beast that I think is different from any other role, purely because when you work in HR, like, you don't just come to work and do your job.
Mm.
Your job actually feeds into every single person in the company, whether that's execs, CEOs, managers, senior managers, junior. It's the cleaners, the security guards, it's, you're literally across everything. And so my day to day never goes to plan. I can write a to-do list until the cows come home and really want to tick all of those things off. But my day is basically based upon the business needs and people's needs. So it's very, very much varied. Counselling and HR are very similar. And my counselling skills puts me in good stead for this position because it's people focused. In HR, you have to do people mediation, conflict resolution, looking after employees' well-being. And so I actually have all of that as my foundation, having a degree in counselling, having got all the qualifications already, and also having experience in working in that field. So people is definitely very much at the centre of what I do, and I actually do and have a holistic approach to people management. So my style in HR is very different from the usual HR style, which means that I'm a different people person.
Yeah. Yeah.
Which puts me in good stead. But aside from that, I'm also an author. So I'm also an author. I published a book last year called Simone Is Still Single. It's a romance novel, but it's a romance novel that is for self-help lovers. I don't kind of say that in the forefront just because I like to surprise people, but because we're all here and we're all friends, I'm actually revealing that it's really a self-help book in disguise. And again, like, I had the opportunity to write a book, and I felt that just in the state of how Black people are viewed and the state of how we are, I feel, in terms of our acknowledgement of self and our ability to enter into counselling, I think there's still a lot of stigma around that. And so having had the opportunity to write a book, I didn't want to just write a love romance fairy tale that isn't grounded in any realism, isn't realistic, and actually just keeps us in a place where we have fantasy ideas about how we get love, how we find love, and how we maintain love. I really thought it would be a really good opportunity for me to use my counselling skills to, from the perspective of the protagonist, who's called Simona Brown, really give an insight into how she thinks and the impact of her decision making. And within the book, there are two counselling scenes in there. The book spans, I think, 4 years. And in the book, there are two counselling scenes that I've chosen to put in there just to give a realistic insight into what counselling looks like and feels like in the most realistic way, because I'm actually a counsellor and I'm going to do it in a realistic way. And it's really important. So although HR, counselling and being an author sounds all really kind of like bitty, the main common denominator is communication.
Yeah.
Communication is at the heart of what I do. And a further extension of that is allowing people, or trying to nudge people, back into self-exploration. So my role as a HR person is not to plan your life, plan your career, and give you what you want. I'm sorry, that's actually not my job. My job is not to make you happy. My job is to help you grow in your career. It's helping you to understand and find the gaps in your capability, fill those gaps so you can become a better person, a better manager, a better individual in the workspace, which in turn will impact your personal life. So I make people accountable for how they're showing up, even whether they like it or not. I mean, they don't expect it, but that's what they're getting from me. And then as a counsellor, which I've also tailor-made into becoming a coach, because I use that skill set in both my counselling and HR profession. It's, again, it's to not provide people the answers. That is not my job. I am not the expert of anyone. I have experience in this field. I have experience in psychology. I'm not the expert. My job is to help you further self-explore and come to find your own answers, because they're all within you. My job is merely just to support you and walk alongside you on that journey. And that is exactly what I do in this book. This book is a non-passive book that enables you to look at yourself should you choose to, because the book is designed to meet you where you're at. if you're not ready to read it, you're going to put it down and tell me or write a review to say it's crap, because I've had that, you know, but it meets you where you're at. So, so yeah, as a person, as an individual person, I'm not really big on titles, but as an individual person, my job is to understand what my purpose and passion is,
yeah,
and show up in areas that help support me being a whole person.
Yeah.
I believe we are all rainbows filled with many different skill sets, and it's our job to leave our gifts here on earth and not take it with us when it's time for us to go.
Well, that kind of is a nice segue into the question that I want to ask you, Lisa. So you mentioned obviously some really key words there that kind of resonate with me. Like, my background's football coaching, so I don't work in it anymore, but I have. But you mentioned sort of coaching, guiding people. There's a lot of sort of guided discovery by the sounds of it with your role and helping people, again, like Steve as well. So obviously through the university, we're going to have a lot of students that are going to be graduating, a lot of Black students that are going to be graduating as well. I'm making a very big assumption here that you've probably found yourself in a position of being a mentor or providing your services as being a role model. If you were to advise a student that is graduating sort of in the next, well, at the end of this academic year or in a year or two, what would be some advice that you would potentially give them when they're kind of stepping out into that big wide world as a Black man or woman looking to navigate the new sort of world of jumping into the workplace?
That is a massive question.
It is, and it's, I want a big answer.
It's massive. So first of all, I would say breathe, because the reality is, if every individual person who is graduating goes back and remembers what it felt like when they were getting their GCSEs or A-level results, just remember that moment, remember how they felt in the moment and realizing that it was massive. They felt they're probably that their world was going to end if they didn't get the grades they wanted. They then have moved through that, gone on to university, got their grades, and now they're thinking, oh my God, I'm entering into this massive world, and future workplace, and I have to be on point. I have to have everything now. To that, I would just say breathe. You have your whole life and whole career ahead of you, and it's just going to look different. It may not fit in with what you perceive it to be because you haven't experienced any of it yet. That's number one. Number two, what I wish someone had told me, but I found out when I walked into the workplace, is that still in some sectors, you are likely to be the only Black person. And I didn't know this word existed until I went into counselling and it was told to me, but the word is microaggressions. Microaggressions, if you do not understand what that word is, and you do not understand how it shows up and how it impacts you, you will think you're going crazy. And it's really important that people understand that we live in a society where we have a meritocracy system, where it's the belief is that you, that your grades account for something and you will be rewarded because you've got a good grade. In fairness, it is to some degree correct. But on top of that, there are layers, and that layers is that we have bias, we have unconscious bias, we have people's attitudes and stereotypes into who they believe that you are. And so in order to fit in, you're naturally, and you may assimilate, you may code switch. Mm. And it's very, very important that, and I know this comes with time, but it's really important that you have a strong sense of self. It's really important. And I know this comes with time because you're still learning, you're developing, you're growing, you're actually finding out who you are. But where possible, really gain a strong sense of self. Understand who you are. Understand that you're a good person. And understand that if something doesn't feel right, listen to your gut, because you're probably correct. Where possible, try and have the confidence to actually question things, to challenge things. And if you're not sure, literally just ask the question. But I do also want to say is that if you do feel something, you are not alone. You're not going crazy. Where possible, try and find another Black person in that organization and formulate a connection, because you're going to have some sort of shared experiences. but you're not mad, you're not going crazy. Unfortunately, as much as we are now in a position where we're talking about diversity and inclusion, we're having a lot of events about Black History Month and a lot of talks, and it's more in the open due to the death of George Floyd. We're still not really there yet. And so what I'm saying is, understand that the world is the way it is, but try and understand that you have to learn how to navigate it and not feel defeated. Yeah.
I think that's you said you were going to give me it was a big question and I wanted a big answer there, Lisa. I think that you put it perfectly. I think I read an article the other day where I think a lot of, there was a stat, I don't want to give the wrong stat, but it was around 50 to 55% of Black workers that were questioned in this survey that felt that they had to assimilate to a whiter way of working or not being themselves.
Yes.
And I thought that was a really interesting stat because I found myself doing it in the workplace. And it can be very difficult for Black people and people of Black heritage and other ethnic minorities to be themselves when they're in the workplace. It is super difficult. But I think that answer was absolutely spot on. I think really.
But on that, can I just, so let me just explain my journey just from my assimilation. Yeah. So I, like probably every Black person, you're told that you have to work 2 times as hard or 10 times as hard as your white counterparts from day. Like that is drummed into you from day. Mm. On that, just a segue, you don't have to work 10 times harder than anyone. All you have to do is do your best. That's it, okay? Then to go backwards. So I, whether I'm lucky or not, depends on how you want to read it. But my name on a CV without a picture, you don't know what color I am. Mm. So my name has never gone against me in any job interviews. But when I have gone to a job interview and they've seen that I'm Lisa Bent, there is a bit of a surprise because they were expecting a white person. You can see it in their eyes. You can see it in their tone. Okay. I learned very, very quickly that if I was to go to work, straighten my hair, whether that's relaxed, whether that's with a hot comb and tie it back. So my style used to be middle parting, slick back with a bun. I knew that if I wore my hair like that at an interview, my chances of getting a job increased tenfold. Mm. If I go to an interview and wear my hair like this or in braids, I felt that the likelihood of me getting a job decreased. So I worked the system. Mm. I was going to the job interview with my hair a certain way, look a certain way, dress a certain way. And then as soon as I got the job, so after I passed my 3-month probation, I would then do the Black hairstyles. The braids would come out, I'd wear my hair out. And then, but then with that, you're going to get comments, which is so annoying because that's another piece you've got to begin well navigate. It's bloody annoying because you are having to explain just who you are. And it's very tiring. And so to avoid that, I kind of didn't do it. So for many years, I've done the same hairstyle, middle parting, slick back, fun. It only took me to my mid-30s where I was like, why am I doing this? Mm. This actually isn't helping me. The gel that I'm using is actually making my hair thin. It's a protective style, but the product isn't good. Mm. So I'm damaging my hair to look aesthetically pleasing. This doesn't make any sense. So now this is how I come to work. You might see me with a head wrap on. I don't actually care because my hair isn't like a white person's hair. This is how it naturally grows out of my head. And I'm not going to apologize for it. And I don't actually even care whether you think I'm beautiful or not. My beauty has nothing to do with you. And so I say that to say, I have assimilated because I was young, but through experience, I have just chosen to put my own boundaries in place because I now have a strong sense of self. And I'm not bending or twisting myself to make it comfortable for other people. It's not happening.
No, and I think you're completely right, Lisa. It goes back to the question that I asked you before, and that's an amazing sort of piece of advice to give to any young person of colour, is to be yourself and understand yourself. It's not easy to get there. Again, Lisa, I'm sorry to cut you off and interrupt, but we're going to move over to Nina. Lisa, thank you very much. And I'm sure we'll hear from you again throughout the evening. Hi, Nina, how are you doing?
Hi, I'm really good.
Good, good. I hope you're enjoying the evening so far.
I am.
Really, really sort of going to go with the same sort of tact to start off the questioning with you is, sort of, can you give us an introduction as to who you are and your background in terms of your career and how you've kind of got to where you are?
Thank you. I'm Nina Christofferson, and I'm a mixed bag of all sorts. I'm a writer, producer, director, educator, the list goes on. I wrote the Billie Holiday story, and I'm going to jump around with the story, but I wrote the Billie Holiday story that was in the West End, and it did really well, sold out, won many awards. And I was so fortunate from the back of that to be introduced to so many people. It really opened up lots of doors for me. And coming back from that, coming into GSA, because I work for GSA, sorry, University, which is the drama school. And I was asked by another colleague, a friend of mine, if I was interested in teaching there. And I've been teaching for many years. I love teaching. I teach the voice, as in singing and speech and or everything around the voice, from gaming to public speaking. And I said, I'd be interested. So I applied and I got the role, and it was just a cover, and it was really, really interesting. And in the interview, they said to me, are you interested in, or should I say, what are your thoughts on the situation with Black Lives Matter and George Floyd? So I was asked that in the interview because it was only a year ago. And I suddenly thought, well, okay, if you want it, you're gonna get it. So I gave them the full wrap. I told them exactly how I felt, what I was thinking, and how it made people of color, indigenous people, black and brown, how it made us feel, and those consequences, and how it was all coming out, and how through time and history, we've been denied so much, and so much of our history has been taken from us and being reorganized and put out as though we weren't part of that history. So the stolen identity was really allowed to come to the surface, really. And they were like nodding their heads, and they took it on board, and they took it really well. And I suddenly thought, well, okay, that's me out of a job. And then they came back and said, we'd love you to take the role. And I suddenly thought, okay, well, if they can handle the truth, then I'm interested. So I said, yes, I'll take the role. I did the role for a year. And then while I was doing the role, another role came up just to sort of talk about EDI. And I shared the role with a lady called Kathy Sloan. And it wasn't a permanent role. It was just the beginning of the role. And I suddenly thought, you know, if this is really going to be serious, and I'm talking frankly, if it's going to be serious, then this role needs to be really embedded into GSA so we can really make long-lasting change. Because I felt we were slightly handicapped because although we were given the title, the reality of the possibility of change was really, really restrictive. However, I felt like everyone wanted that change. So it was how were we going to maneuver ourselves into a position where we could actually start that change? As it was, the role was reorganized because of so much change with management, and the role came up and I was allowed to, you know, as you do, interview for the role amongst everyone else. So I did, and I got the role. So now, just starting September, I am now, director of Equality, Diversity, and Inclusion as well at GSA, as well as being a senior lecturer. And I've started really trying to embed a different kind of culture. And when I say started, because it's just so much work, and I couldn't pick up with everything that both Kathy and myself were doing because it was massive. And just to run with that straight away, it just takes time. So basically, we started with workshops, we started introducing a different kind of language, we've got champions on board. So we're really trying to really change the machinery. And what I really was really pleasantly surprised was how much the university has really backed that idea of change and wanting growth and wanting, both the students and the faculty to really come on board with this new way of being inclusive and the new way of really tackling and understanding different cultures and heritages and making that a way of life within the common workplace, as in the common community of the university. And I was so, I'm really at this moment in time, I'm really pleased that I don't feel like I've been stopped. In fact, I think I've been enabled so much by a lot of the faculty members and given the, you know, given the reins, so to speak. What can you do, Nina? Lead, you know, we're here to learn. We want to learn. We know we have to change. And I think that's a really unique position to be in. And I'm really sort of pleased with that opportunity. And so I think everyone seems to be okay with my long emails of me explaining how we're going to go about things. And we're starting forums, and the first student forum is going to be on Monday. I'm just trying to find a venue. And so really, I'm just really hitting the ground running. And it's kind of raw, but raw and exciting, because we're at this time where we really can have long-lasting change. And you know, we talk about the institution being a problem. It has always been a problem. And, you know, how do you unpick it? I mean, can't go in there with a sledgehammer, because, you know, it's gonna break, because that thing hasn't been moved for a long time. So, you know, it's about working with each other and having continual conversations where we can learn from each other and where we can really start putting change in, that we can all feel like we can, it talks to all of us, and we're not looking at it thinking, I can't identify with that. So those are the things that sort of brought me to today. Cutting straight in there.
Yeah, I mean, Nina, just kind of sitting and listening to you, you are clearly a very strong woman, yes. Both in sort of in your mindset and knowing what you want to do, and a strong Black woman as well, which is an amazing thing for us to have at the university. Obviously, the demographic of where the university and GSA is situated, it is a very heavily populated white area. I've moved to the area in the last sort of 2 years, and you do find that. How have you found, I'm not sure whether you live locally, but obviously with you being at GSA, how have you found navigating that, being a Black woman in an environment that is heavily sort of dominated by the white population?
I think when you're an artist, you go into many environments where you're the only person of color. So you're used to navigating, you're used to those extra sensitivities, the radar is up immediately, you can read the situation really quickly, you have to assess what's going on very quickly in order to make yourself feel comfortable in that situation, in order so you can have a voice within that place. So you assess so quickly. For me, I'm an ex-GSA graduate and alumni just a few years back, and so I'm used to that situation of having to navigate. I don't like explaining myself, so I don't. It's as simple as that. I think if I have to explain myself, I'm making excuses for who I am. I'm not prepared to do that. I feel like I've done my due diligence. I've you know, I'm educated, I'm polite, I'm well-mannered. I think that's enough. I come with enough traits that we can have a conversation, we can have a laugh. I know what's going on in your life, you know what's going on in my life, ha, 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 and let's play from there. So I like to play, and the idea of play, it allows us to sort of not go in hard-headed. It allows us to sort of investigate in a joyful way and know that it's okay if it's not right. It's okay if we don't get it right. That, you know, but it's a language we use to correct ourselves. That's the important thing. I think if we, don't have that extra sensitivity of learning how to communicate with each other, then we do come unstuck, because we'll say the wrong things. It's that idea of thinking before you speak is really important. So I tend to, for me, as a Black woman, and when I was training, I was the only person of colour in my year, a Black lady, and there was another gentleman who was Indian, and I think that was it in terms of diversity. Mm. And he left after the first year because it was too much for him, and he didn't feel like he belonged, he didn't feel like it spoke to him, and he felt like that there were barriers to him. I'm also an opera singer as well as a jazz singer. I sing in 5 different languages, of course, and that's another one of my musicals. So I embed a different kind of culture in the work that I do deliberately. For me, even though he didn't feel like that, I came from Birmingham. So I was thinking, well, I don't care who you are. I've got smarts and a little bit of attitude. So I brought that attitude into the room. And I suddenly thought, well, if my talent is not good enough to be here, if that doesn't give me a level playing field, then I don't know what would. So I just came with that attitude. And luckily, I think a lot of my classmates, there was a mixture of some being my allies and some being very indifferent and some from a much more wealthier background and quite judgmental. Mm-hmm. But for me, I that's not my end goal, how they think. You know, my end goal is graduating and making sure that I get work in the industry. So I could park that. And also, because I'm a bit of a joker, as in I use humor a lot to get around a lot of things, because if I think there's a sting in the air, I'll crack a joke in to break it down, because I need to be able to operate. And that's my way of coping. But I don't think anyone should have a coping mechanism. I think my point is, and this is what I'm trying to get across when I'm doing the EDI, it's about having a language that we can all communicate with each other, a respect for each culture. That is the important thing. It's not about having coping mechanisms, because if you do, that means that there's something that's wrong in that environment and you're having to really assess and make changes in order for you to fit in. And I don't think that's really the way forward. I think the way forward is really for us to change our language, change the attitudes towards each other, really looking at the curriculum, how it speaks to us as a culture, as a community, not just a Black community, I'm talking about community at large, you know, Black, brown people, people of colour, and, you know, our current community, and making sure there's a better balance. Because we don't have a balance, we are looking at situations where we feel like we're hitting a brick wall, you know, excellence is not enough. You know, it's like that glass ceiling, where does it stop? You know, it clearly stops quite low, you know, in certain countries. And that's a problem. You'd say, you know, which is why even in the arts, when you think of some of the wonderful artists that we have, they go to America in order to make their career. I mean, people are all saying to me, aren't you going to go to America? When are you going to go to America? And I'm thinking, oh, maybe I should. But you need, because there's a reality. There's a real reality to this, you know, there's a reality to it. That if you're not allowed to really flex your muscles to the excellence that you are, then you're not allowed to grow. So it means that you grow to a certain degree. And then after that, you kind of die if you don't continue that growth. So you diversify in order to keep that machinery of excellence that you have. But you shouldn't have to always diversify. You should just be able to be great in the one field and be able to reach the top and respected for that. But it's not always the way. And I think that's the kind of thing, when I thought about this role, I thought, well, you know, I want other students to have a better and an easier way, an easier transition than I did. I mean, and I say that I did have it fairly good, actually, I have to admit. And literally only because, like, you know, I would be what you call a triple threat, you know, as in I could sing, dance, and act. And then, you know, I played a role called Medea, fantastic. I sort of thought, RSC National going to come calling, you know, film role. It didn't happen. None of it happened. And then I suddenly thought, well, Billie Holiday. So I was doing a tour, and I thought, oh, if I said I had a Billie Holiday show, would they take it on? They said yes. So I suddenly thought, maybe let's see what happens. And I put it out there, and it was great. Some producers that I worked with in the Netherlands, I did, you know, Rocking on Heaven's Door, where I was playing a Sweet Inspiration, which is a Black gospel singer for the Elvis band. So it was one of those three ladies, you know, so singing away. And they said yes. So with that, we all went to Edinburgh Festival to decide which venue didn't go with them in the end as producers, because I suddenly thought it didn't work out. And the venue I went with was absolutely brilliant, Riverside Studios, Assembly Rooms. And they said, yes, we'll take you. We love the show, love the idea. I mean, they took the idea of the show within two sentences. You know, I just said, hi, I'm Nina Christopherson, I'm a big holiday story. And I also played Medea. and then they said, yeah, great. And so they said, we'd love you to do it. And I suddenly thought, oh, wow. I can tell the story, because this is how, you know, I will share it. I hadn't written the show yet. That was the thing. I hadn't written it. And then I sort of thought, okay, I've got a fantastic venue, got a producer. They said they were going to back it. So I took it away and I thought, oh, wow, okay, I've got to write it. So, but I had played Big Holiday before. So I sat down on the computer, had all the story, did lots of research, wrote itself in a night, basically. And I just, all the good and the bad stuff just came out on the page. But because I'm a strong actress and because I'm a strong singer, I suddenly thought, I really want to showcase those skills of mine. So I just put it all there and I thought, oh, it'd be really great if I was doing this and this and this and this. So I put everything I wanted to do in the show. And I suddenly thought, I didn't think about whether the audience were going to like it. It was just about me enjoying my role, performing and what that would be. And luckily, when they saw it, by the time we finished and got it at Edinburgh, it sold out in 2 weeks. Which is amazing. Fantastic. Yeah,
that's amazing.
Thank you. But the amazing thing was I didn't have much of a team because I couldn't afford one. So it was just me, my pianist, and a friend of mine said, you can't go up there by yourself. And I thought, why not? I should have thought, you know, well, I'm singing and it's a one woman show. I'm singing and I'm doing all the acting. And so as long as I've got my pianist with me, and he was great, Warren Wills at the time. And we just both went up there and it sold out. I got an extension for another 2 weeks and then ended up a year later in the West End with a different MD, Alan Rogers. Warren couldn't do it, but Alan Rogers, he does Strictly Come Dancing Arena Tours. He does that. So he's absolutely brilliant. So he's, you know, amazing. But I met him when I was in Edinburgh. And that was a cute thing. And then it sold out and it was word of mouth. It was a small team again and fantastic five-piece band, brilliant jazzers. And because we sold out, it just allowed us to hit through the roof. What I'm trying to bring everyone to the equation of is never stop. Yeah. Never let anyone quantify your ability to achieve. Never let anyone tell you what you should do and what you can't do. You know, set your own limitations, set your own goals and map out how you're going to achieve them. And for me, allies came from left, right and center.
Yeah.
Literally.
I think, what I was going to say there, Nina, is from the conversation that we're having and the story that you're telling, I think the key message there is kind of grab the bull by the horns, and that goes to any student, anyone in the conversation of the webinar this evening, whether you're a student or whether you're not. I think sometimes you just have to kind of carve your own sort of journey, don't you? And I think that you're a great example of that. You've been fantastic to listen to. And again, I hate to interrupt and stop everybody's stories, but we're going to move over to our last guest. So thank you again, Nina.
Thank you. The story
is absolutely fascinating. For Lauren, I was just wondering, I'm trying to spot you on the screen there. I've got about 16 people up on the screen. You're still here.
I'm still here.
For Lauren, thank you for being so patient. And
No worries at all. It's been amazing to just listen to the stories from Lisa, Nina, Stephen. It's so inspiring, by the way. So big fans.
I mean, hopefully you're going to inspire us even further. So as I've said to everyone, for Lauren, if you could just give us an introduction as to who you are, your career to date and kind of how you got there, that would be amazing.
Sure. So what I do day to day is I'm a client advisor within a large American financial institution called JP Morgan. And I work within their wealth management division. So I advise very wealthy individuals who are based in the UK on what they should do with their wealth, how they can achieve their goals. And those goals could be life goals, financial goals, whatever it might be. But most of the time, my job is to translate that into some form of a strategy of how they execute that over, in some cases, over a period of 10 to 15 years. That's what I do kind of as one of my two hats. The second hat I have is I'm also part of the leadership team and management team for the UK Private Bank for JP Morgan. So I have a bit of a kind of management strategy responsibility as well. So that's kind of my day-to-day. I have a little mini hats around different quarters, but we won't go into that because that's kind of that day job is my core. I'm still in the office, so that gives you an idea of how much of my core it is. And my journey, honestly, I was listening to everyone else's journey. I just kept thinking, I need to change my story and my journey. And I thought, but honestly, my journey really starts where I was born, which is in Nigeria. I left Nigeria when I was 17. The idea was, you know, my family were, you know, at the time, and I'm not that old, but there was still a little bit of a middle class in Nigeria at the time. And that obviously changed after I left, and it was very much lower and upper. And the little, you know, wealth that the family had, they said, look, we're going to throw it all into your education. So you need to go abroad and you need to, you know, get more grounded education. So it was Ireland for a few years, and then eventually landed one or two gap years because I wasn't as structured as I come across today in my life, and then landed in University of Surrey. And then that's when the real story really took off, and studied electronic engineering. And the interesting thing about that journey is I think after my first year Surrey, I said to myself, I don't think I want to be an engineer for life. I kind of thought, I need something else. I need something more dynamic. I need something that interacts with people every single day. And don't forget, back then, this is before the tech, you know, the socials, all the wonderful things. And I wish I did stick to engineering, but let's park that for a second. I just kind of thought, I need to move away from this and I need to find a home somewhere else. And finance just kept coming up. So obviously, you know, started that journey trying to understand a little bit more. I'd always had an interest in economics and kind of things financial pre that journey. So it was fairly easy mental transition to make that call. And then obviously that's when you start and you fail a lot. And I think for anyone who knows someone who's been on that journey trying to get into finance, it is extremely difficult. And even more difficult when you're, a black person or black student trying to get into that space. And I do recall, and I think it was something that Nina said that just, I literally vividly remember going to the careers office and saying, here's my plan. I want to work for this company. It's called JP Morgan. Do you guys have any association with JP Morgan? And the lady was like, I'm really sorry, we don't. You know, they tend to go to, you know, Warwick, LSE, Oxford, Cambridge. So sorry, I think you're just going to have to go on this journey on your own. And I was like, okay, fine, thank you. And I literally just walked out and I was like, okay, I'm doing this on my own, and this is where I'm going to go. And I did 40, 50 applications. I got three interviews out of 40, 50 applications. I flunked my first, and I know I flunked it because it was my first. So I walked out of there going, there's no way they're hiring me. And then the second and third, obviously, when you learn from your first, you kind of, you're ready for the second. And this company, which I've been at for 15 years now, there was a match. That was the great thing about the interview. I loved what I saw. They loved what they saw. And I started that journey. And 15 years on, I'm still in the same company, still in love, still enjoying what I do day to day. They keep pushing me, I keep growing, I keep getting challenged, and that's the only reason why I'm still here, 15 years on, which is very rare in finance, by the way. Very rare.
Amazing achievement. But Lauren, the one question I wanted to actually ask you was, you mentioned that you moved over from Nigeria over to Ireland to start off your education. which is a really interesting route and must have been a massive culture shock.
Yes.
I don't know too much about Guinness, but I'm not sure whether they have it in Nigeria. So
yes, but the Guinness in Nigeria is better than the Guinness in Ireland, but that's a debate for another conversation.
Same in Jamaica. I can tell you that as well.
Different argument, but no, it was so the root of that was someone who my mum really trusts their opinion said, you have to send your son there. If there's anywhere you're going to go, send him to Ireland first. Like he might get lost in the UK. So yeah. Why not send him to Ireland first? And, you know, at the time, there isn't that much to do. So he's not too distracted.
Yeah.
And then eventually he can land in the UK when he's a little bit more mature. And I was 17 at the time.
Mm.
And it worked really well. And it's interesting because the nickname that I kind of picked up and kind of carried on into Surrey, which is Flo, kind of started in Ireland and it kind of carried on all the way into Surrey. And I don't know if I put it in my bio, in 2005, I also ended up being the first Black student union president, also the first international student who was student union president for University of Surrey. And obviously that name just kept going and going and going. And now I go back in Surrey and everyone's trying to call me that. I'm like, no, my name is Falara. But yes, so it was an amazing journey.
What I was going to say, Falara, is that journey, making that journey at such a young age, 17 years old, I know I couldn't have done anything like that at 17 years old. You then mentioned that you kind of put 40, 50 applications in. Do you think that journey created you as a person and sort of created that hardiness and that real determination to, like you said, you give an example of putting 40, 50 applications in. Do you think that helps kind of shape you?
So I think it's interesting because one of the things about, and I will answer your question, but one of the things that actually morphs Black individuals is really what has been your journey as a Black individual. And a Black individual who was born and raised in the US, a Black individual born and raised in the UK, a Black individual born and raised in Nigeria, they're three very, very different people. And they operate very differently. So for me, for 17 years, I was dominant. There was, you know, I grew up in Nigeria. I didn't understand what racism was. You know, you see it, you potentially may see it on TV shows every once in a while, growing up as a 17-year-old. But for you, it's kind of like, you know, my mom raised me to be, you go and you get whatever you want to get. There is nothing you cannot achieve in life. And that was the 17 years. And then you jump into this world where you go into Ireland and the UK, and then you start to see this thing. And it's a slow creep compared to an individual who is born in the US or born in the UK, because they see that from day one. So for me, it was kind of this gradual thing where you're like, hang on, is this actually happening? And they're like, no, it's not happening. And it's the microaggressions, you know, that you know, Lisa talked about. I think it was Lisa who talked about microaggressions, and it just builds and builds and builds. And for you, it's almost like a compressed journey of learning all of those things in the space of a couple of years, and then you kind of get to about, you know, 4 or 5 years in that journey, and then you then realize how to navigate, as Nina said, go into a room and kind of know exactly what to say and what to do, to ignore, be confident, to decide that if you can't accept me for who I am, then I don't need to be in that room. I could be in another room where they're going to accept me for who I am. So it's an actually interesting thing. So I think for me, it was just, I think what got me for the 50 applications to keep going and to kind of not say, you know, not take no for an answer, was actually the 17 years of just being able to be groomed as a person without the extra piece of microaggressions or intolerance or anything else. And then obviously then, you know, my journey is slightly different. And then, you come into the workplace and you literally then start to learn, you know, new ways of dealing with things. So slightly different.
Well, Laura, it's so interesting. I think your journey is absolutely amazing and super inspirational. Like I said, for me, I had an opportunity to go and coach over in New York at New York Red Bulls when I was about 21. And I don't regret anything in my life, but that's one thing that I wish I'd just taken that leap and done it. Obviously, there's no regrets because I'm glad that I've found my wife and found my home and things like that. But sometimes you just need to do those things to kind of help shape you and take those, that sort of that leap of faith. But no, your story is super inspirational. And thank you for sharing it with us. I think, again, apologies like I have to everyone for cutting you off short, Lauren. But I think we're going to open up to questions now. So I don't know if anyone has a question. If you do, please feel free to put it in the chat. If not, and you'd like, you feel comfortable enough to kind of do it over the chat, feel free to raise your hand and turn on your microphone and ask. But yeah, I'm not sure if there's any questions.
Yes. Hi, Nathan. I've got one from Alfred. He says, why is it that GSA is the only school that has a director of equality, diversity and inclusion? So I think that one's to Nina.
Why is it only GSA and not the university? Simply because I put forward a really challenging proposal and I fought hard for it, really. And whatever we do at GSA, I know at the University of Surrey do have sections of equality and diversity as well, and they are looking at things, and we're just looking at it in a different way. We're a smaller unit, we operate slightly outside of the university also, but within it. And also our model of training is completely different from the university. And we felt that being in the arts was really important that GSA really had a voice that was more unified in order for us to move forward together. Because the students as well were really pushing for more representation, more diversity, more inclusion. And there was no getting away from it. It was either going to be now or never. And luckily, the university said, yes, we support that. And GSA went out and looked for it. I hope I answered that question. Did I answer it?
I think you covered it there. Yeah, definitely. Nathan, I think Ella's got a question, and there's one in the chat as well.
Thank you, that's fine. Let's go to Ella first. So Ella, if you're happy to unmute yourself, that'd be great.
Okay, yes. Good evening, everyone. This question is actually for Mr. Oyeleye, and we do have similar stories. I came from Nigeria to England in 2016. But I just want to ask, as a wealth manager, what is the best part of your job?
Well, there are quite a few. I think the most rewarding piece of my job is watching a plan that I've put together over a period of 5 to 7 years come through. And I think one of the things about being a good wealth manager is you are really embedded in the individual's life, because they are telling you plans for their children, ideas for their children, plans for their partners. You're preparing for things that you hope never happen in their life. You're doing that with them. You're holding their hand through that entire journey. So actually getting through all of that, planning through and executing and getting the right kind of returns that the client is looking for, and being able to execute, whether it's a pot of wealth for a child's education, let's say in the US, for example, something along those lines, just seeing that come through, it's very rewarding. So I know my industry doesn't necessarily paint itself in the best light, but the reality is with wealth management specifically, you are really helping people achieve what they want. And it's a lot less cutthroat than, the TV and films position it to be. Because you're dealing with humans. I deal with human beings every single day. And they come in all sorts of different shapes, sizes, colors, with different needs. And you have to be ready for that.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thanks, Lauren. I think, Jocelyn, did you say you've got a question in the chat that you wanted to put forward? Oh, just on mute, Jocelyn.
Be one, wouldn't there? So, we've got a question from Emily in the chat. I wonder whether any of the panellists had had any mentors in their career journeys that have been particularly impactful. So we haven't heard from Steve for a while. So, Steve, do you want to go with that in terms of if you've had any mentors in your career journey and how were they impactful to you? Oh, you're on mute like I was.
No, I haven't had a mentor as such. I think in my field and the area in which I had my training, I was quite a unique individual. So there wasn't individuals to turn to and to look to. I had to find it within myself and call upon my historical experiences as a Christian minister. And I wish I did, because there are times where the doubts that come up that may have come from my childhood, growing up in a very tense time as far as race is concerned, geographically, I could fall back to those ways of being, of being head down, placating the dominant culture. But as time has gone on and as I've grown as a person, I've been able to draw on my inner resources. And that has sustained me up until now. But I'd have wished I had a mentor, but I didn't, unfortunately.
Can I jump in, Jocelyn, if that's okay? So
yes.
I totally resonated what Steve said, because there is an element of that, and it's in everyone, and you have to pull that through in order to really get through being, as I think all four of the speakers have kind of identified, you're one of many, one person in a room that is dominated by other races. However, one of the things I have used to help me, and I think this started probably just pre-leaving universities, I started this concept, and it just came as an idea, and I don't think it's a unique idea, where I started to build a group of individuals around me and not leaning on just one person. And these individuals come from, different backgrounds and have different experiences. Someone in finance, my older brother, who I really look up to, is in that group. And it's almost like they almost kind of became my board of directors of my life. And I would constantly go to them to kind of say, here's what I'm thinking, here's the move I'm about to make, what do you think? And they would kind of turn back to me and go, I think that's a really stupid idea. And they'd tell me why, and they'd talk me through it and understand. And it was almost a group of individuals just making sure that I didn't make as many mistakes as I did. And as the years have gone by, those individuals have changed slightly. And some people drop off and some people take, some people I don't speak to for about a year, but it's okay. They don't, there's an understanding there. They don't really know. I call them my board. They just think, we just have a relationship, but they're a group of people that I can reach out to for advice and for support. And when I look at that group, majority of them are not Black. And the reality is, it's just people I connect with, people I respect their opinion. They've shown me that they have clarity of thought and they are honest about their views. And I do listen to them a lot. And there've been so many decisions I've tried to make where they've talked me out of it. And I'm so glad that I had that group to kind of lean on when I'm about to make, again, these rash decisions that are driven by, multiple layers of microaggression that you felt in the office or, outside the office in the community and so on. You're always kind of being pushed to make a decision that you actually shouldn't make. So that's been really helpful for me.
Can I also answer that?
Yeah.
Flo, what you said was incredible. I'd never even thought about that. You know, I have WhatsApp chat groups and some are like good and some are just like celebrity chat. But anyway, in my career as HR, I've never had a mentor. I've never had a person who works in HR that looks like me. I've always been a black person in the most senior position, and it's been really difficult because you're navigating on another level because you're dealing with CEOs, global CEOs, etc. So it's been quite difficult, but I've somehow managed to navigate effectively well. But having a mentor would have been fantastic, regardless of the colour. It would have been really nice to have. However, when I was writing the book, I got a mentor and for the first time really experienced the value of that. So I don't know if you know Dorothy Cumson, but Dorothy Cumson is one of the top best-selling black authors in the UK. And I've never written a book before. And my book was part of a book deal. I was part of the 20 in 2020, which basically means that last year, I was one of 20 new authors all to be published in the same year by the same independent black publishing house, which has never been done before. And it's groundbreaking. Which is great, right? But I haven't written a book before. Hello, where do I even begin? So I've known Dorothy for a while due to my previous career, which was a TV presenter. And I just basically reached out to, I hadn't spoken to her for a while, but I reached out to her and said, Dorothy, look, as you know, I'm part of this. As you know, I've got a serious deadline. I don't know what I'm doing. Please, I know you're really busy. You're probably writing another book, but please can I just come and see you because I need guidance because I feel like I'm drowning and these deadlines are coming closer and closer. She said, Lisa, if you can get on a train and come to Hove next week, Friday, I'm going to give you 3 hours of my time. I'm in my own book deadline, but I'm going to give you my time. And I'm like, oh my God, I'm so there. Thank you. She gave me her time. And it wasn't until I came back to London that same day that I realized how close her deadline was. Because when, by the time I got back home, she submitted her deadline. And I'm like, what? That's insane. And I think now she's written 19 books. So she's written and published one book every single year for the whole of her career. It's incredible. So I say that to say, I reached out. No one came to me. I reached out. I asked for help. And in that, she just so happened to say yes. So I say that to say, if someone hasn't offered to be your mentor, but you are inspired by someone, or you respect someone, you admire someone, you lose nothing in just asking. And I think more times than not, people do want to help. So you need to just get out of your own way. Don't try and think for them. Just ask the question, very succinctly ask what you want and just be as authentic as possible and just see what they say. It was the best thing that I ever did because she's an expert in her field and she literally got me to hone in, make every word on the page count, don't tell but show, make your characters believable, make them rich, get out of your own head. Don't focus on the word count. Meet your deadline. Do not use the excuse that you are a writer and therefore you're going to have writer's block. You wouldn't go to work in HR or finance or anyone else and say, sorry, got writer's block today, can't work. You wouldn't do that. So don't make the excuse just because you are now an author. So those kind of words helped me. And in telling you, I'm sure you can tweak and apply that to your own life. So yes, having a mentor is really important and just ask for what you want. Thank you.
Fantastic.
I feel like I should jump in as well.
Go for it. The floor is yours, Nina.
Be wrong not to. I've had many mentors, to be honest. I think when you're in the arts, and I've always had lots of singing lessons and singing coaches, especially, you reveal a lot about yourself, a lot about your voice, and it becomes like a very intimate session. And a lot of these singing coaches really are, they really sort of pushing you to get a job, get to the next stage, you know, whatever it takes to be of excellence, because in order to to do well, you are always competing in the room, and each job you go for can be a very short contract, can be a long contract. It's never long enough in the arts. So they're always building confidence in you. And to be honest, with a lot of these singing coaches that I've had, they're always like, oh, you're amazing. Just remember there's room for you too. You know, they come up with these sayings that, you know, if I suddenly thought, oh gosh, I haven't gotten that. And then, you know, they would just remind me of my own excellence and not to be afraid. And also my parents were incredibly, really beneficial for my growth as an individual. I was really close to my mom and dad, and they would feed me with lots of examples of life itself and what happens if you're Black and how to navigate life and what to do and what to hold back. And those things really helped me. And to this day, I use them. To this day, it's given me ample use of discretion. So I don't always say everything. I see a lot, but I don't always say what I see. That kind of discretion and ideas that you get from the wise, you know, the older generation that is suddenly, you know, just tossed away because, you know, people say they're too old, but no, the experiences are what helps you to navigate your own journey, because often they can be very, not just supportive, but the caring nature of them not wanting you to make the same mistakes that they made. That is so really powerful. They will pour into you their knowledge if you allow them, you know. So, you know, for me, I've just had so much allies, support, mentors. And, you know, wherever I go, I think this is where I'm lucky. And wherever I go, I always get favor. I mean, I push a lot. I push with my passion, and my passion allows people to see who I am, and they meet me halfway. And then they become my mentor. For me, really, really, really grateful for that. So that's me. There's loads of them out there. You don't have to look far. You just have to show your passion. They'll jump on the bandwagon with you, I think. That's what I would say.
Fantastic. Thank you very much to all of you for getting involved in that question. I think we've got another question here, which could definitely spark a little bit of debate, I think. And it's a really good question. So Kay Holder said, evening all, what are your thoughts on the term Black excellence? Do you see it as an aspiration tool, or do you think it potentially harms those considered average or middle class even? So, I mean, I kind of put that to the floor, really. Has anyone got any thoughts on that?
I personally don't like the term Black excellence. I think it's another layer to serve a division. It's an extension of you have to work 10 times harder. And I don't personally think it's helpful. You know, we don't talk about white excellence, Asian excellence, Japanese excellence, Chinese excellence. I think it's just another barrier for us. For me, I'm just all for good enough. Whatever you do, do it to the best of your ability, and that is good enough. That's it. The Black excellence, I think, is also a term that almost creates a superhuman level. So if you work in a field and it's tough and you've managed to break through, oh my God, you're Black excellence. I don't think it works like that. It's more complicated than that. And I think it's very easy to, because of the term, make people feel like they just haven't made it or didn't have the extra stuff that enabled them to succeed. I just don't think it's helpful. It's another layer. We don't need this. It's just another shackle, if I'm being honest. I get the term as a term of, in spite of all odds, you made it. I understand it from that level, but it's still not progressive for me. And it still causes problems and division. And I think it's another label that's unnecessary, personally.
I wouldn't be a student politician if I didn't love a good debate and take the other side. only for the debate, Lisa, don't worry. We can have it over a drink, only for the debate. I think the other side to the argument for the term is, over the years, and I think there are quite a lot of sectors that are in this space, not many, but there are quite a good amount of sectors, at least definitely in the UK, where there has been a lack of spotlight being shown on people who have done very well in that space. And over the years, let's say the last, let's call it 5-7 years, pre-George Floyd, it's only in the month of October where everyone feels like it's the best time to then say, oh, by the way, this person invented the blah, and that person invented the blah, and you didn't know that, and this person did this, and that person's great. And the reality is, in our day-to-day lives, you know, in the healthcare sector, in the transport sector, engineering sector, the arts, and, you know, let's take away sports and entertainment for a second. I have a real gripe with sports and entertainment and how that is, you know, it's easy to shine the spotlight on a black person on sports and ents, and then everything else is just kind of, you know, under the carpet. I think the reason the term was coined was on the basis that people in, and I'll use my industry, finance, people in law, people in, you know, all sorts of different fields, day-to-day fields that are important to our day-to-day, weren't getting the spotlight. So it was coined as a view to say, look at that person, you're a, you know, 5-year-old, 10-year-old, 15-year-old black boy or girl, look at that individual. You can be that person. If you work hard and you do all the right things, you could be that person too. And I think I think that's what's packaged in it. I know it's now been, again, because of the social media culture that we have, it's now being celebrated in different ways. But I think that's, for me, that's how I think the genesis of it could have been, in terms of spotlight.
Can I just add on that point? Just, and I'm going to shut up afterwards. Totally get what you're saying. Totally hear you. But still, the language for me is problematic. All it then needs to be is black contributions, and to literally highlight, to honor, to celebrate the contributions we have made. The term black excellence, we are running with it, and it's creating for me another layer that makes a superhuman and then a subhuman kind of category that just doesn't progress and help us in terms of, therefore, what we feel in terms of how successful we are, because we are not on a Serena Williams level, a Tiger Woods level, a Lewis Hamilton level, but day to day we are on levels and we're succeeding. Just because we're not in the public eye doesn't mean that we're not successful. So I feel like it's becoming problematic because not everyone's going to reach black excellence because the focus and the spotlight can't be on them because they're not in those entertainment, those sport fields. So for me, this is about stop whitewashing, stop hiding, and literally call out the contributions black people have made across the world. The fact that black history doesn't even appear in the school curriculum as history, because black history is British history, because we don't own the storytelling, is really the fundamental problem as to why no one knows the contributions that we've made. So that's, I'm gonna shut up now.
So isn't it just the idea of us, you know, continuing our story beyond October, really, and actually highlighting the brilliant work that we're doing as a, that's why I say it's about the community and the language we use. It is so overly sensitive because, you know, in one arena we're honouring someone else, and in another we're not honouring them. And there's that comparison that's always constantly being made. Am I good enough? What does it take for me to be good enough, to be considered to be good enough? When, you know, as you're saying, we're all contributing to the bigger whole, the bigger picture. So it's you know, how do we, you know, I will say, how do we actually get that story across, as in how do we constantly share all of our stories where, you know, we've managed to contribute to the bigger picture as a whole, and we've made groundbreaking statements, groundbreaking moves, progressive, and has been highlighted, and you know, I as an EDI director, you know, I've opened the Black History Month to 365 days, so we can constantly celebrate, you know, the contribution of everyone, rather than it just being over a month, because that's not realistic and that's not true. It's a story that continues beyond a month. You know, it happened not just because it's in October. And it, I think by trying to squeeze in the brilliance of the contribution in that one month is very problematic in itself.
I think it's really, really interesting. At least I had never, ever really thought about it from that perspective before. So that's a massive sort of eye-opener to me. I mean, like Falarin said, with social media and trends that go around and easy words that just get bandied about, Black excellence can be deemed as a way of celebrating the culture and people that are doing well for the culture as well. But I think it's a really interesting point that you put across there, and it's made me kind of look at it from a different perspective. Sorry, Nina, did you want to say
something? No, I was just going to say, just because some of those, if you think about Black excellence, some of the individuals who we give those titles to do not pour back into the community. Hmm. And I think that's what the problem is. If you're going to say someone has Black excellence and you're going to, you know, elevate them up, then you're going to want them to pour back into the community as well. So it's, you know, it's a cycle. So they, you know, they lift others up rather than it just being the individual. And I think those are the things that are problematic around labeling and getting the labeling right, because it really shouldn't be any labeling. It's normalization of the brilliant work that individuals are contributing to the whole. I think that's what we're trying to achieve here.
Yeah, I think a really interesting point for me is you guys all work in different forums, different roles. What sort of things have you guys seen within your industries that have looked to kind of, we're talking about Black excellence now, what things have you guys seen within your industries that have celebrated successful Black people and culture? Have you seen anything that's been standout for you that potentially we as a seed group at the university are always looking for new ideas of how we can better celebrate Black culture, and especially, again, this is Black History Month, but like you said, Nina, across 365 days of the year, we want to do this, and that's why we have that commitment to having seed. But it'd be interesting to know what you guys have seen across your industries, and if there's been anything that you would like to share, that'd be amazing. Think for Lauren's going for it.
No, I definitely, Lisa, Nina, if you want to go first, please. Okay, I should go. So in my industry, there's obviously there's a real problem around diversity. So it's beyond, and to put this bluntly, it's beyond racial diversity. It's gender diversity. It's, you know, it's a bigger issue, and it's something that the industry has been trying to work through for quite some time. And I've actually gotten quite involved. I'd probably say my journey of really getting my hands rolling up my sleeves was probably 2015. But there are multiple layers to trying to address the problem. There's the grassroots level, at least for my industry anyway, there's the grassroots level, which is what the employees and the, you know, through the employee network, there's a support that can be created. So for example, you know, as with most other financial institutions, JP Morgan has a Black employee network, and it's a group of people coming together. And that's what I call the grassroots. So kind of baseline level, you know, bottom looking up, saying, here are the things that we need in order to kind of help the group. At that grassroots level, it is important to emphasize mostly on inclusion, because it's very easy to come together as a group and then be exclusive. So the emphasis, when I rolled up my sleeves and got involved, and led the employee network for 2 years was, how do we get a good Black employee network has more white people than Black people. That's a good Black employee network, because what you are doing is you are educating, you're parting knowledge, you're celebrating, you know, you're enlightening. And as black employees, you are probably unlearning things that you've learned, which are defensive mechanisms to kind of counteract some of the microaggressions and intolerances that you've had over the years. So it's bringing the parties together. So that was the grassroots level. And then obviously then there's kind of the top-down level, and that really has to start from the top of the food chain. The person who's responsible, CEO, you know, MD, whatever you want to call them in whatever organization, coming down at a, you know, strategic perspective around what is important from a culture perspective within the firm, what is acceptable as culture and what is not, how the inclusive culture. And then coming up with a strategy of making sure, and this is where it always gets wrong, by the way, middle management is where it always gets wrong. Creating measures, trackable measures to make sure middle management are actually incentivized through things that they probably shouldn't be incentivized by, but unfortunately you have to, because that's what corporate world is. To make sure that they are doing the right things as well for the grassroots. And they are, you know, they're making, so that was kind of the broader kind of framework that we've been using, not just in the firm, but in the industry. And it's, you know, it takes time, but it's working. And that's across, you know, recruitment, retention, development, you know, all of those things, culture, inclusion. I wouldn't be in JP Morgan if they weren't getting those things right. I would have left ages ago. And they're not perfect, but they try. And this is, by the way, across all the diversity streams. This is not just about Black employees. They really make an effort, grassroots level up, top down. You know, CEO is extremely vocal about what we do externally for Black employees. And he's not shy to say that. And he talks about it all over the world, wherever he goes. And we, you know, we were one of the first few firms in the financial industry to actually have an individual who is employed to think about Black employees day to day. So not an EDI person who's got one eye there and one eye on their day job. That's the person's day job. Wake up every morning, think about our Black employees. Mm. So, you know, he's really kind of put it out there, but it's not the easiest thing to do. But it's kind of two ways. Sorry, and I'll shut up now.
Fine, and then I'll just jump in to say that's really interesting, because you're doing grassroots and then top, and then it kind of like somehow meets. Whereas here we are literally like this, because what we understand is, and this is from also the HR standpoint, is that it's not HR's job to fix diversity and inclusion. It's not Black people, Asian people, or any underrepresented minority to fix the diversity and inclusion issue. It's not our job. We're already traumatized. So I'm sorry, but I'm also not here to also solve the problem and give you solutions on top of my trauma. I'm not doing it. I'm also not here to educate. Not doing that. I'm here to share if I want to share. Don't expect me to share just because I'm a Black woman and the only Black woman in a senior leadership position. Don't do that. If you want that, pay me extra for my time, but we're not doing that. So we have, and rather than having just like a Black network or a Chinese network, or, you know, we have a network called Building to Belong. So we have it as diversity and inclusion together. We can't separate because it needs to be inclusive. So the group is made up of everyone from all walks of life at every level. Because we're not going to do this hierarchy thing where HR tells you, HR informs, HR measures, and therefore is supported by CEOs. And then everyone just has to try and fall into line because we need this really good data. It's like, no, this is the group. This is how it is. This is how we move. And in the group, we work together to create pillars. And with each pillar, there are measurable goals that we set with the outcomes, so we can see the impact. Once again, though, as you pointed out, even in because of how this company is, we Black people are underrepresented. It's a company of 240. I think in this group, there's probably 5 Black people. And I think they're the same 5 Black people who are actually in the company. So there is work to do under different banners of employee engagement, recruitment drive. When we do the recruitment drive, what do we need to do to retain them? Because at the end of the day, you will only understand what inclusion really means if you felt excluded. And the majority of people who feel excluded are the ones who are a minority. So to try and get the majority to understand what exclusion means, you've got to paint different kinds of pictures, you know? And there's also cultural nuances across the board. And so that's what's been really important. But the drive here in this company, it doesn't feel like it's a tick box exercise, which is really, really refreshing. Everyone is so, 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 so lovely. However, what I have noticed, because I was the person who did, we didn't call it Black History Month, we call it Black Future Month. And the Future Month isn't to ignore that Black history exists, it's to acknowledge that we are here, we don't want to talk about social injustices, we want to talk about the past, the current, and then the future. So I designed the whole, I created the whole program, and we've had some amazing speakers. But what I've noticed is that for the 4 series that we've done so far, the last one's next week, the numbers have been shocking. This is a company of 240 people, and the lowest amount of people that turned up was 24 people. So when it comes, and then when there's like pride, the numbers are bigger. And that's probably because there are more people who are of different races who may happen to identify under that banner. But when you talk about Black History Month or Black Futures Month, there's still an idea that, oh, that's for Black people and I may attend, but actually I've got this meeting, let me go and do that. And so the impact and the opportunity to really make a change is limited because people don't really care. That's the reality. If you take that out of HR and just view it as how many people have watched an all-Black cast at the theatre? How many people have watched an all-Black film? You will find that not many people have watched things that don't look like them because they're not interested. Why would they? So I say that to say the discussion, the educational piece is consistent and it's continuous, and this is not going to happen overnight. And I think a lot of people got into trouble after George Floyd and posted the Black Square, which had no meaning, no substance, no foundation, no plan. And council culture came and literally exposed a hell of a lot of people from schools to universities to organizations. And so the meaning now has to be put in place. And the last point I want to make is there are so many organizations that are just trying to do diversity and inclusion by themselves. Little workshops here, little workshops there. Each organization needs a dedicated D&I person to literally be in these spaces to ensure accountability happens and the level of knowledge is being, what's the word I'm looking for? What is this? The level of information is being
accessible. Thank
you. That's the word I'm looking for to all. But this is complex. This is not going to happen overnight, because if the UK in their report recently expressed that the UK isn't racist and therefore has no institutional racism, and yet we have the Race Relations Act of 1965 that was put in place because there was racism, then we are still in denial on the very fabric and basic level that society is built on. So then how do you expect work to get it right when society, which is led by the government, aren't even acknowledging the existence from an institutional level, and they're the law setters. So we need to give each other a break. This is, you know, we have to do this and we're in for the long haul. This is not going to happen overnight, and it may not even happen in our lifetime. That's the reality from my perspective.
Yeah, I completely agree, Lisa. There's a big debate, and it was very, very big in my household when George Floyd was murdered. and it was a stressful time for everybody. And it was a debate between my sister and myself. And my sister was very much of the opinion at the time, probably have to ask her now what her opinion is on it, as to whether it was her role or her, or whether she, not her role, that's too much of a pressure, but whether she was happy to kind of educate her friends who were not people of colour, and whether it was, whether she was happy to do that. And for me personally, I remember saying to her that I was happy to have those conversations with my colleagues. I was happy to have those conversations with my friends. My friendship group is predominantly white, whereas maybe hers isn't. So maybe that's why I've got a bit of a different opinion on it. I live in a predominantly white area. She lives in Croydon. So she might have a very different opinion on that as well. But the debate was basically whether she was happy to be that person who would have those conversations, whereas I was happy to have those conversations with people. I was just wondering what your thoughts were as a panel in terms of, I know, Lisa, you were kind of saying that you're tired. You've got these things. There's trauma. You don't need to have added trauma. I completely understand that. But my thought process with it is, if we are able to have these conversations with our white colleagues and our white friends, surely that's going to open up conversations to make this, and I don't want to say this because they shouldn't have, but to make them feel more comfortable to approach.
Not your job. I'm going to come straight in.
I know. And this is, I'm kind of just prodding a little bit.
Yeah.
But I want to hear your opinion on it.
Yeah. I'll be very short because I have spoken a lot. It is not your job. It's not your job. You should not be, and this is the thing, in a conversation of race, and you've seen it on Good Morning Britain with Piers Morgan, there's an expectation that you have to justify what racism means, and therefore by doing that, you're justifying your experiences. If I'm saying my experience is X, don't challenge me on it. That's my experience. And so it is not your job to educate, number one. If you want to reveal your experience, you can do so, but then what happens after that, you're going to have to manage from a mental capacity point of view, right? And you may not be in that space because it's tiring. And we have been saying this for a very long time, but now all of a sudden everyone wants to listen. I'm sorry, but I'm done with my processing. I've been having these conversations since 2009. It's not my fault that now, because of George Floyd and the fact that we were in a global pandemic where everyone was faced with having to acknowledge a situation because we couldn't go out nowhere, there was no distractions, that now you're ready to have the conversation, that I should now oblige you. This is not how it runs. I'm very sorry. Number three, there are so many resources out there now that if you want to understand and learn, go read a book. Because trust me when I say, my whole experience of the Black experience in the workplace and just in life, I've had to process that. And so really, you're not going to get the true acknowledgement of my existence in this 10-minute conversation you want to have, but then you want to get up and walk away because you can do that. I couldn't do that. And so it's not your job. If you want to, totally up to you, but there are a lot of resources out there and a lot of people have spent a lot of time trying to write it down in a way that it's coherent, succinct, and it explains. So they need to find those resources. And all they've got to do is Google. There's a whole list out there. You are not the provider to... You're not the provider in their enhanced knowledge of why things are the way it is. I'm very sorry. And I'm really passionate on it. So I'm saying what I'm saying to you with love, and I hope you receive it that way.
Oh, of course not. So, Lisa, I don't actually, I was saying it was a debate, but I don't really, I don't think I should be out here educating and preaching. My standpoint on it is very much about, if someone asks me a question, I'll be open and honest with my opinion. But I very much agree with what you're saying. There's loads of resources out there. And actually, if you'd asked me at the beginning of when George Floyd got murdered, I would have said I would happily educate people. But it was mentally draining 2 or 3 months into it. So my opinion very much changed. And my sister won the debate, basically, which doesn't happen often in our household. So I let her have that one. I'm going to go on to another question, because obviously we're kind of getting towards the end of the guest. Oh, have we got a raised hand? Tricia?
Yes, you have.
Go for it, Tricia.
Going on from the discussion between you and Lisa, I think Lisa is right in the sense that, you see, many people, I don't think, are prepared to listen to the honest truth, which is not what we say, but if you go and search for it, it's there. That is the thing. And they will walk away. As you get into the nitty-gritty bit, people walk away because they can't handle the truth. And sometimes it sounds like it's just only your experience, but it's not only your experience, because any human being who is not objective, well, you are not ready for tomorrow. So in actually telling the story, you've got to tell it from an objective point of view. And when you tell them the truth, which sometimes even within your own community, if you are becoming objective, they think, well, this girl is sold herself. So the truth is in the library. You will find it worse than what we can tell you. And when people say, oh, isn't what happened in Ashwick the most terrible things that happened to human beings? And I stand, by the way, I work for the University of Surrey. So I stand up, I said, no, that's not correct. And they said, Tricia, how can you say that? I said, because yes, I can say that because it is true what happened then was terrible, but it's only the most terrible thing caught on camera. What happened to people like us is the worst, but it's not caught on camera. This is why it's so uncomfortable for people to listen. And it's still going on, but it doesn't actually have to dictate what your life is going to be. Your value as a human being, as Lisa said, in different ways, value in terms of do the best that you can in the job that you've been given with integrity, and with passion, and with a sense of humor, coming from Nina's point, you will find that people in the end actually see the true person that you are and the value that you bring to the institution. Initially, many people will have different idea of who you are, but when they find out what you are, from your work, from the interaction they have with you, from the relationship you have, and from your own values, it's a different thing. But truth is sometimes very difficult for people to handle. So, sorry, I just thought I would add it.
No, Tricia, really appreciate that. You're completely right. And I think that is one of the key things, isn't it? Is truths and people being open to understanding and listening to those truths as well. And actually not listening, there's a difference between sort of active listening and passive listening. And I think it's so important that active side of things is really sort of initiated when we're having these conversations, because it's very easy just for one thing to go in one ear and out the other, or like you said, Lisa, to just get up and walk away. The last question I'd like to put to the panel before we go, is looking to the future, what advice would you offer to those starting out and to allies that are looking to support?
Maybe I can speak here. There will be a difficult road ahead. And there has to be an appreciation that nothing is going to be a smooth path. There will be challenges, whatever field you're in. If you're a person of color, in the world that we live in at the moment, there'll be times when, and I just noticed in the chat, K holders, but we are tired. And as Lisa said, we are tired of explaining, of pushing, of having to hear the negative responses that come when you bring the truth forward. So yes, even though there's going to be difficulties, there's going to be obstructions, there's going to be challenges, there will be a ceiling that looks like a glass ceiling, you can break through it. You can break through it if there is a sense of self. I think Elise was talking about a sense of self earlier, that if we can build a strong sense of self, the future doesn't have to be as pessimistic as it could be. Some will say, well, this has been going on for 50, 60, 70 years in this country since the Windrush generation, pushing and not being able to come through. But we have seen change, even in the smallest way. And if individuals can hang on to that, say, look, this is me. I'm going to give it my best shot. And if I give it my best shot, I have no regrets. I can't change the world. I can't change the perception that people may or may not have of me. But I'm putting that to one side and I'm going to plow on through. And I will get that hammer and tap through that glass ceiling and get there.
I just love how you talk. God, your voice is so calming. It's so calming, Steve.
It comes in handy in the job.
Wow. Gosh. My contributions for those just starting out is be aware of the world, but don't let it define you. To be of the world, to understand how the world works, to understand your place in the world based upon the projections placed on you is very, very important, because you have to navigate it whilst not wearing it. To allies, I think you said it, Stephen, the importance of listening. So if something isn't your direct experience, it doesn't mean it's not true. We are working in different lenses, different realities, even though we all live in the same reality. And in order for you to understand, just understand that it's not necessarily down to the other person to inform you. You can go and read, you can go and educate yourself. And again, it comes back down to what I think my purpose is, which is about communication and using different mediums to nudge people gently into further self-exploration. You cannot talk about race. You cannot be an ally if you're not willing to look at your own unconscious and conscious bias about who other people are and who you are in relation to those other people, because you are going to have an opinion. And it's about understanding and going all the way back to try and work out where your opinion comes from, who told you that was the way, why do you believe what you believe? And now it's just basically the time to challenge everything that you ever thought, not just of yourself, but of the other. Because very often, those from minority groups, we get othered. So when I say other, it's not just Black people I'm talking about. I'm talking about Asian, Chinese, Japanese, everyone who doesn't look like you. Why do you believe that? And also just to understand that what you do believe is also informed by television. Black people are, I feel, the most group of people who clearly just have negative stereotypes. Day in, day out, negative stereotypes. And that informs potentially why you cross over the other side of the road when a group of Black boys are coming towards you. So it's understanding how your biases show up, and to work on yourself to undo that. So challenge your own thinking.
Lovely, Lisa. Shall I just quickly jump in? I know we're running out of time, but I would just say pursue what you want. Don't let anyone tell you you can't do anything. You make your own choices in life, although others will want you to feel that they are pushing you in a direction that they want you to go. Decide what you want in life, actually map it out, plan, and find ways to actually achieve it and go for that. It is achievable. Everything in life is achievable. This is where allies can come in and actually support your dreams and support what you're trying to do. And if you're talking about allies within the Black movement, the Black contribution, if you think about just those around you who already try to lift you up, who already listen to your woes, your heartaches and difficult times, just try and use those allies immediately and let them help support your future. And also as allies, I think if you would like to step forward even more and put yourself in the firing line before, because you know what it's like often, because that's why you are allies, because you can see it, you have a different sensitivity. So you put yourself in the firing line and take the blows that a lot of people of colour have been taking. And I've put myself in a position to actually take those blows, because I read an article, several articles, saying that, you know, those people of colour that have achieved a lot, it would be great for us to go back into the community and actually help navigate the situations that are really difficult, and actually, you know, help with sharing of the pathway to achievement. And that's one of the reasons why I came back into education. I've always been teaching, but I've been teaching within my own school. But I, for me, if I felt like if I can help GSA to reshape, because it's one of the best schools in the world, it will have a massive impact and influence on lots of other schools. And I'm determined, and it will do. And I hope that will follow through, and others will learn from the examples we put into place, like forums where we can share the stories and where we can actually hear from the individuals and actually implement and make change. So it's a cycle of movement, and it is achievable. Although we're tired, everything's tiring, but you may as well have fun while you do it, right? So that's what I've got to say, just very quickly. Thank you.
Nathan, I know we're running out of time, so I'll be quick. I think for anyone who's coming up, I think the message for me really is take your time and be patient to learn your craft and learn your trade. There is nothing more powerful for any individual, irrespective of race, gender, and so on, is that they understand and are patient in their craft and their trade, because it'll set you apart from everybody else. And you know, definitely agree with what Nina, Stephen, Lisa said as well. And then in terms of allies, I think the message is to make a change, it needs to be embedded in your day-to-day. And what you'll realize is that some of the challenges, the racial challenges we have in society, are actually embedded in day-to-day. So become intentional with your allyship in your day-to-day, whether it's how you purchase, you know, supporting Black businesses in how they grow because they are underrepresented, or it is, you know, calling out, you know, you're walking on the street and you see something that doesn't look right and you don't know who the individuals are, go and support that person who has been, you know, treated badly or not tolerated in any setting whatsoever. That's the definition of the allyship. It's not, you know, it's not the waving the flag or wearing the, you know, kind of the lanyard or jumping into Black History Month activities. It's really every single day you wake up and you think, what can I do to make a difference? And that's the true allyship, because that's really where we need to break the mold, is in our day to day. It's in the community. It's in how we live our lives. It's not in what we do in our organizations, which is where these things are being highlighted. So that would be my message for allies.
Thanks, Valoran. And thank you to everybody else who's been involved in the conversation, Lisa, Nina, and Stephen as well. Thank you so much. Jocelyn, I think obviously we've kind of come towards the end of the talk. It's 8:03. So I'm going to hand over to Jocelyn quickly just to close up. But thank you to everybody who's been involved this evening. It's been lovely to meet everybody. This is the new way of meeting, isn't it, I guess, and doing these panel talks. It's been a great success and I've had a great time hosting it. So thanks, Jocelyn, for asking me to do it.
Thank you, Nathan. You have done a fantastic job. You've, you know, Nathan did one called Kick It Out last year, which is actually on the university website, and did a fantastic job. So I made sure I nabbed him for this one. So thank you very much. Lisa, Nina, Steve, Valoran, I can't appreciate you. It's just fantastic. You know, I wish I could see you in person. This is so difficult not to be able to, you know, really, you know, carry on the conversation, but you've all been so brilliant in sharing your experiences. And I know everyone who's been able to attend tonight has really enjoyed it and learned a lot from it. If any of you wants to share any contact details of people to stay in touch with you, I know Steve and Nina, you're already with us at the university, that Lisa or Falara, if you wanted to share how people can stay in touch with you or follow what you're doing, now's a good time to do it if you want to. Lisa, do you want to do that quickly?
Yeah, sure. I was just going to drop it in the group. But yeah, I'm basically on, I don't really use Twitter as much anymore, but I am on Instagram, if anyone's on Instagram, and you can obviously DM me, and that in the chat is my handle.
Fantastic, thank you. Falarin, do you want to
I'm not an author. I don't have a public profile. It's just me. So yes, I guess LinkedIn maybe. So
fantastic. Well, we know you're all the great things you're doing, so we can stay abreast of you. And I know, obviously, being alumni as well. And Steve and Nina, if you wanted, Nina, you've put your details there in the chat, so thank you. So it's Nina Christofferson, and Steve, if you want to put anything in the chat, that'd be fantastic. But yeah, we're going to let you go and enjoy your evening. So thank you again for being with us. Any feedback you want to send through, you can send it to the EDI teams. That's edi@surrey.ac.uk, or you can find myself, Jocelyn Chandler Hawkins, or Victoria Patterson in the university staff inbox and address book as well. Okay, brilliant. Enjoy the rest of your evening, and thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Lovely to meet you guys. See you later.
Nathan, lovely to